afternoon everyone. Welcome to the second session of VTU eShikshana program. In yesterday's class we have discussed about the different number systems like decimal, binary, octal and hexadecimal numbers, and then also we have discussed the conversion from one type to another type. Also we have discussed the functioning of different logic gates like OR gate, AND gate, NOT gate, NOR gate, NAND gate, exclusive OR and exclusive NOR gate. We also discussed different types of adders like half adder, full adder and then the parallel adder. Half adder being used for two inputs, full adder are being used for three inputs, and then for more than three inputs we need to go for parallel adders. Then we have discussed briefly about decoders, then different types of flip-flops. Also we have discussed the different terminologies which are used in the computer, like bit, which is stands for 1 bit, then nibble, which stands for 4 bits, word for 8 bits, then kilobyte, megabyte, gigabyte and then the terabytes. Also discussed different types of buses which are used in the computer, like address bus, data bus and then the control bus. In detail we have discussed the importance of the address and then the data bus, how many address lines are there, how many data lines are there, and briefly we have learned the working of central processing unit, wherein we have discussed about arithmetic and logical unit, which basically does the different arithmetic operations and then the logical operations. Then we have discussed about program counter and then the instruction decoder. So in today's class we'll be discussing further things. So the learning outcome of today's class is the student should be able to understand the difference between the microprocessor, the microcontroller and then the embedded system. So what are the similarities between these three things? What are the difference between these three things? Also we need to familiarize with the different applications of embedded systems. Why microcontroller is required, why embedded systems are required. Can all these things be done using a microprocessor also? And then finally, we need to understand the different criteria which are used for choosing a microcontroller, right? There are different types of microcontrollers are there, 8-bit microcontrollers, 16-bit microcontrollers, each one having different RAM, then the ROM. Then question comes, which microcontroller we need to use. So there are different criteria are there. We need to look into all those criteria and then we need to choose the that particular microcontroller. Okay, first and foremost, we need to understand what is microprocessor and what is microcontroller, what are the similarities between these two and what are the differences. If you're looking at the diagram, this is known as what a block diagram of microprocessor. You can see that there is a central processing unit, then there are input devices, the RAM, random access memory, then ROM, read-only memory, then serial interfaces, the output devices and then the timers. You can see that all the devices, from timer to input to RAM to ROM to serial interface and then the output, all these things are connected externally to the CPU. That means in case of microprocessor, which is also known as what general purpose microprocessor, doesn't have RAM, doesn't have ROM, doesn't have IO port. Meaning of doesn't have means what? We don't have on chip. So here the CPU acts as a processor, wherein all these things are there outside the CPU or outside the chip, and all these things are connected externally to the CPU. This is known as what general purpose microprocessor. Whereas if you are looking at the microcontroller, you can see that there is a CPU, there is a ROM, there is a timer, there is a RAM, there is a ROM, there is a IO devices, there is a serial interface. That means what all the things we have outside the chip in case of general purpose processors are being embedded on a single chip. That means in case of a microcontroller, everything is there on chip. So you can see that microcontroller has a CPU, right? It is also known as what microprocessor. There is a RAM there is a ROM, there is a IO ports, there is a timer, there is a analog to digital converter and other required peripherals. So by looking at the block diagram of microprocessor and microcontroller, one can easily say that microcontroller is nothing but a microprocessor along with all the externally connected devices which are there on a single chip. That is known as what microcontroller. Now here the question comes, what is the advantage of having all the connected peripherals on a same chip, right? Or in detail, what happens if you have all these things which are connected to the processor externally, or what happens if everything is there on a single chip? That means processor and the controller, that means microprocessor and microcontrollers, has at its own advantages and then the disadvantages. That means the advantages of connecting all these things externally has got the advantages, similarly some disadvantages. On the other side, on the flip side, there are advantages of having RAM, ROM, timer, IO, EPROM, serial interface on a single chip, and also has got the disadvantages. So if you look at the block diagram, right, one can easily should be able to differentiate between microprocessor and then the microcontroller, right? So once again, what is microprocessor? Microprocessor is a CPU and all the required things are connected external to it. And what is microcontroller? All the required things, be it RAM, ROM, to timer, to counters, all are there on a single chip. So if you look at the definition of general purpose microprocessor, right? In case of general purpose microprocessor, as we have seen, RAM, ROM, IO ports and the timers are not there on a chip. So we must add all these things to the CPU to make them functional. Okay. So in this case, what happens is the system becomes a bulkier and the cost factor is also more, right? It becomes a more expensive. This you can say as a disadvantage of a general purpose microprocessor, that is bulkier system and then the more expensive. But on the flip side, there are advantages also, right? The main advantages are we have a versatility of adding the amount of RAM, ROM and then the required IO ports to the general purpose microprocessor. That means in some cases I may require a particular amount of RAM and then the ROM. For some other cases we may require some other RAM and ROM, some quantity of RAM and ROM. So this can be done in case of general purpose microprocessor, right? For example, for some application we may require 64 kilobyte of RAM. For some applications we may require 128 kilobyte of RAM. So this is possible in case of general purpose microprocessors. Whereas coming to the microcontroller, right? If you look at the block diagram of microcontroller, right, everything we have on a chip, that means RAM, ROM, IO ports, timers, counters, everything we have on a chip. So we have a fixed amount of ROM and then the RAM and also the number of IO ports. For example, in case of 8051, we have four IO ports, four ports are there. So all these are fixed. So the advantage is what? This becomes an ideal for many applications where the two important parameters, one is the cost, the other one is the space. In such applications, microcontrollers are best suited. For example, if you take a TV remote, right? What is the basic function of TV remote? Moment you press some functions, it generates some sort of signal. So we require a very small processor, and then depending on what function we want, it generates the signal. Right? It doesn't require a high processor. Leave about today's core i3, core i5. It doesn't require 8086 also. A small processor is what we require. Whereas on the flip side, in many applications, the space it takes, the power it consumes, and then the price per unit, right, are much more critical conditions than the computing power. As we have discussed about the example of a TV remote, right? Here computing power is not at all required because we are doing a very small basic function. In such cases, microcontroller plays a very important role. So, to the question whether we need to go for general purpose microprocessor or to the microcontroller, it basically boils down to for which application we want to use it, right? If you have an application wherein we need to do multi functions, like if you look at a system which does many functions at a time, right? It can be used for Word, PPT, printing, gaming, internet, many things, right? In such scenario, general purpose microprocessors are preferred. Whereas in applications wherein the function is very limited, like a TV remote is there, one of the example, wherein, right, we are not bothered about the computing power. In that scenario, microcontrollers are best suited. Then we have one more version is known as what, embedded systems. So an embedded product uses a microprocessor or microcontroller to do one task and only one task, right? That is known as those systems which does only one task is known as what, embedded systems. There are many examples of embedded system. The best examples are what, like ATM or the washing machines. What they do, they will do only one task and only one task all the time. So there is only one application software that is typically burned into ROM and it will do only that function. Whereas if you look at a PC, right, in PC there are many number of applications we can do. That means it has a RAM memory and an operating system that loads a variety of applications into RAM and let CPU run them. And a PC contains or is connected to various embedded products. Each one peripheral has a microcontroller inside it that performs only one task. So in a sense, what we can say is a PC is a combination of different embedded systems. Whereas how we define embedded system, it does only one task. What is PC? PC does many tasks. So again, whether we need to choose an embedded system or we need to choose a PC, it depends on whether we are looking for only one application at all the time or we are looking for the different applications. So using these things, one can easily decide whether we need to go for embedded systems or we need to go for a PC. Now look at the some of the applications of embedded systems. All these applications are divided into different groups: home applications, office applications, and then automobile applications, right? Sometimes there are some examples which falls under both the category or all the three categories, right? So if you are looking at the some of the home applications, right, the embedded systems are used in home appliances. It can also be used in intercom, telephones, security systems, garage door openers, answering machines, fax machines, home computers, TV, cable TV tuner, VCR. Right. Nowadays, we don't know, most of us may not be knowing what is VCR, camcorder, remote controls, video games, cellular phones, musical instruments, sewing machines, lighting control, paging, camera, pinball machines, toys, exercise equipment, right? You can add many things, right? The devices or the applications which does only one work all the time, all that can be classified as what, embedded systems. So these are the few examples of home applications of embedded systems. And then coming to the some of the applications of embedded systems in the office category are telephones, computers, security systems, fax machines, microwave, copier, right? Most of the time for this copier we know as Xerox machines, but keep in mind that Xerox is a company. Right, the correct terminology is what, photocopier. Then there is a printer, there is a color printer, then there is a paging. Right, if you look at the printer, what is the function of printer? Printer always does only one work. What is that work? Printing. Or nowadays we have a multifunction printers wherein it can be used for printing as well as for scanning. Then there are some applications of embedded systems in automobile category, right? Trip computer, engine control, airbag, ABS, anti-braking systems, instrumentations, security systems, different transmission controls, entertainment, climate control, cellular phones, and then keyless entry. Nowadays, the vehicles are coming with this facility of what keyless entry. So all these are the examples of what the embedded systems. So what we have discussed up to now is we have discussed about what is general purpose microprocessor, what is microcontroller, and what is embedded systems. Right. So for the embedded systems, basically one can use either processor or the controller, but you can find that at most of the cases, the controllers are used in the embedded systems. Now look at some of the important things. Manufacturers of general purpose microprocessors have targeted their microprocessor for the high end of the embedded market. There are times that a microcontroller is inadequate for the task, as we have discussed that. Right. What is embedded system? Embedded system basically does only one work at a time. So I can use simply microcontroller. But there are high-end applications wherein the microcontroller may not be sufficient, then I can use the microprocessor also. That means in an embedded system, either you can use microprocessor or you can use a microcontroller depending on what type of work we are doing. When a company targets a general purpose microprocessor for the embedded market, it optimizes the processor used for the embedded systems. Like if I have an application where a processor is required, then if we use the microcontroller, right, there is no optimization. Or if I have an application where only a microcontroller will do, and if you are using microprocessor, again it is underutilizing. So we need to get into the detail of what exactly we want to do in the embedded systems. Depending upon them, either we can use general purpose microprocessors or the microcontroller. Very often the terms, like if you are looking at the slide, red one, embedded processor and microcontrollers are used interchangeably. So don't get confused with the terminology embedded processor and then the microcontroller. Most of the time, both these are used interchangeably. And then one of the most critical needs of embedded system is what the power consumption and then the space. Now look at the application of embedded system. For example, if you're talking about ATM, the basic function of ATM is to for the withdrawal of the amount. So it will be doing only that work round the clock. And then as most of the embedded systems works on a battery, right, the amount of power consumed by these embedded systems should be as low as possible. And then also the space. So these are the very, very important needs before deciding for the embedded systems. In a high performance embedded process, the trend is to integrate more functions on the CPU chip and then let the designer decide what feature they want to use. That means instead of giving very few functions and then asking the user to use it, if I want more than one application, then I need to purchase one more. So now nowadays what people are doing is they are integrating many applications on a single chip. And then it is left to the user whether to use one or two applications of that or to use all the functions. If you look at the microcontroller, right, there are 8-bit microcontrollers, there are 16-bit microcontrollers, and there are 32-bit microcontrollers, which are manufactured by different companies. So if you look at the 8-bit microcontroller, it is Motorola 6811. Then there is an Intel's 8051. That microcontroller will be studying in detail during our next this semester. Then there is Hilux Z8. Then there is Microchip's PIC. Right. Apart from these 8-bit microcontrollers, we also have 16-bit and 32-bit microcontrollers manufactured by various companies. Right. As we have discussed in the yesterday's class, the meaning of 8-bit and meaning of 16-bit or 32-bit microcontroller is, at a time it can operate on those many bits. If it is 16-bit microcontroller, it can operate on 16-bit at a time. Right. Also, we have discussed that what happens if you want to operate on a 32-bit in a 16-bit microcontroller. You can do it, but these 32-bit operations can be done in two stages in a 16-bit microcontroller, or if I use 8-bit microcontroller and if you want to perform 32 bit operation, then this can be done in four different stages. But only the disadvantage is what, in a 32 bit microcontroller, if you are performing 32 bit operation, that can be done in a smaller amount of time, or the execution time is very less. And if you want to perform the whole 32 bit operation using 8 bit microcontroller, right, the total time taken will be 4 times what 32 bit microcontroller will take approximately. Now coming to the criteria for choosing a microcontroller. Now in a market, you'll find different types of microcontrollers, and then we need to know the different criteria before choosing a microcontroller. These microcontrollers are also known as what, itty-bitty processors, IBP, right? Because it is used for some smaller applications, so for that purpose they are also known as what, itty-bitty processors, IBP. So if you're looking at the few points which are mentioned there, these are the few points which we need to look into before choosing a microcontroller. First and foremost is the speed, right? For choosing a microcontroller, we should know the speed at which that particular microcontroller is operating, right? For that, we need to look into the clock frequency. We need to look into the how many bit microcontroller it is, whether it is 8 bit or 16 bit or 32 bit. And then depending upon our application, we need to choose either 8 bit or 16 bit or 32 bit microcontroller. Also, the microcontrollers comes with different operating frequencies. So basically this boils down to the speed at which we want to execute or complete the task. Then second important criteria is the package. The ICs or the integrated circuits will come in different packages. Some of them are known as what, DIP, dual inline package, and then QFP, quad flat package, right? Basically these packages are very important for space and then the assembling concept. So the second important criteria for choosing microcontroller is what, the packaging. Third and the most important criteria is what, the power consumption. That means how much amount of power it is consuming for performing a operation. As we have discussed that, most of the microcontrollers or the embedded systems are battery operated. So if a microcontroller embedded systems consumes more power, then it is a sort of disadvantage. So the power consumption should be very low. The next important criteria for selecting a microcontroller is what, the amount of RAM and ROM what we have on chip. Different types of microcontrollers comes with different types of or different amount of RAM and ROM, right? 8051 comes with different amount of RAM and then the ROM. Then the other flavors of 8052, there is 8052, there is 8031, they comes with different amount of RAM and ROM. So we need to look into the amount of RAM and ROM what we have on chip before selecting a microcontroller. Then the next important criteria is what, the how many input output pins we have on the chip. For example, as we have discussed, 8051 has got 4 ports and each port has got 8 IO pins. So 8 into 4, 32 IO pins. Meaning of 32 IO pins is what, those many devices can be interfaced. So we need to look into the number of IO pins which are there on a particular microcontroller. Basically, this depends on what applications we are looking for and how many IO pins we require. And then also we need to look into the timers, the number of timers what we have on chip. In case of 8051, we have two timers, timer 0 and then timer 1. Further, all these timers can be operated in different modes. In detail, we'll be discussing all those things in the subsequent classes. So the fourth important parameter for selecting a microcontroller is number of IO pins and then the timers. The next important parameter is what, how easy to upgrade to higher performance or lower power consumption versions. Always in electronics, always in the ICs market, we need to look for the upgradation to the higher versions and then the lower power consumption. Whatever, let us assume that today we have selected 8051 for some of the applications, right? after some days, after some months of time, right, if higher version microcontroller comes, right, this 8051 should not become obsolete, right? It should be easy for upgrade to the higher versions or for the lower power consumption versions. So always you take any device while purchasing, people will look for these two important things. One is what upgradation for higher performance or lower consumption versions, right? Last one becomes very, very important, right? You have all the things: speed, package, power consumptions, amount of RAM, ROM, number of IO pins, timers, easy upgradation, everything is there. But if the cost is more, then people will not buy it. So the important factor is also what cost per unit. This also plays a very important role. Right? We can give an example of what, let us assume that we want to purchase a mobile phone, right? And when we visit a mobile showroom, right, we'll be looking for different what you call facilities in the mobile, right? We want high megapixel cameras, selfie cameras, then memory, right, 4 GB or 8 GB RAM, then main memory, right, then its aesthetic look, everything, right? We want everything in the phone. But if the cost is more, then we'll not be able to purchase it, right? Most of the people will not purchase it. So cost plays a very important role. Then furthermore, criteria for choosing a microcontroller, right, is what the availability of software development tools such as compilers, assemblers, and then the debuggers, right? If you're looking at the previous slide, right, there are 6-7 different criteria what we have discussed for choosing a microcontroller, right? From packaging to the power consumptions to the cost, right? Everything is okay. We have purchased it, but we don't have a available software development tools, right? There are no compilers or there are no assemblers, and then there are no debuggers. Again, it is of no use, right? So this again an important criteria for selecting a microcontroller. Then wide availability and reliable sources of the microcontroller. In the area of microcontroller, Intel is the main manufacturer. So 8051 family has the largest number of diversified suppliers. So Intel is the original, and then there are many companies which also fabricate these microcontrollers or manufacture these microcontrollers. Few of them we have mentioned there. There is Atmel company, there is Philips, Signetics, there is AMD, there is Infineon, there is a Matra. Earlier Infineon is known as what, Siemens. Then there is Dallas Semiconductor, Maximum, right? You can always interrelate to these companies, right? When we're talking about systems, desktop or laptop, right, we'll always look at the advertisement, Intel inside, right? And then we know the Philips company, then we know Siemens, then we know AMD, Atmel. So basically the companies which are there in the market for PCs, right, all these companies are also there in the domain of microcontrollers also. Right, before getting into the summary, right, I would like to briefly look into the 8051 microcontroller family, right? So Intel introduced 8051. This is also known as what, MCS51, and this came in the year 1981, right? In the year 1981, approximately around 30, 40 years back, the 8051 is an 8-bit processor. As we have discussed that the microcontroller comes with different bit processors, whether it is 8-bit, 16-bit, or 32-bit. So 8051 is a basic microcontroller. So it is an 8-bit microcontroller. That means at a time we can operate on 8 bits. The CPU can work on only 8 bits of data at a time, as we have discussed, right? If you have a 16 bits, then these 16 bits can be divided into two parts, 8 bit and then 8 bit, and then it can operate it in two different stages. Right? If you are looking at what 8051 has got, right, 8051 has got 128 bytes of RAM on chip. If you remember the block diagram of microcontroller, right, what we said is microcontroller has got everything on chip. There is a CPU, there is a RAM, there is a ROM, there are timers, counters, ports, everything is there on the chip. So in case of 8051, along with the CPU, we have a 128 bytes of RAM on chip, then 4 kilobytes of on chip ROM, then there are two timers, timer 0 and then timer 1, then a serial port, then we have a 4 input output ports, each 8 bits wide, so totally 8 into 4, 32 IO ports are available, and then 6 interrupt sources are there. Right, we'll get into what this interrupt is there in a little bit of time. So go back to the block diagram of microcontroller. Right, so if you're looking at this, right, 8051 is what? It has got a CPU, it has got a timer on chip, two timers, it has got a RAM, it has got a ROM, it has got a 4 IO ports, right, it has got everything on chip, right. So different microcontrollers comes with different amount of RAM, different amount of ROM, and then different IO ports, right. So basically, as we have discussed in the criteria for choosing a microcontroller, that depends on what, right. So there are some applications wherein we have a only 128 byte of RAM, that is sufficient for some applications, and we have a 4 kilobytes of ROM, that is sufficient for applications, some applications, and we have only two timers, again these two timers are sufficient. So if I have an application wherein all these things are sufficient, then you need to go for 8051, right. Whereas if you have some applications wherein 128 bytes of RAM is not sufficient, then don't you go for 8051, select the other types of microcontrollers. So 8051 become widely popular after allowing other manufacturers to make and market any flavor of the 8051, but remaining the core compatible, right. So as we know that it came into the market in the year 1981, Intel has introduced it. And then it allowed the other companies to manufacture the versions of this, right. But code compatible, it means what? The code, what we can run in Intel 8051 can also be run on the other types of microcontrollers. So after this, many companies came into the existence, and then they have manufactured the different microcontrollers. Now look at the 8051 architecture. Right, if you are looking at the architecture, right, this architecture is again similar to the block diagram what we have discussed, right. So if you are looking at the block diagram of 8051 architecture, so there is a central processing unit, right, and then there is interrupt control. We have discussed that there are 8 interrupt controls are there in case of 8051. There is on chip ROM for the code, there is a on chip RAM. There are two timers, timer 0 and then the timer 1. There is a oscillator for different frequencies. Basically, these oscillators and then the bits will determine how fast the executions are. Again, in 8051 comes with different frequencies. We'll discuss those things in detail. Then there is a bus control. Then there are IO ports, right? You can see that there are 4 ports are there, port 0, port 1, port 2, and then the port 3. You can see that all these ports are bi-directional. Each port has got 8 pins, so P0.02, P0.7 or P3.02, P3.7. So totally 32 ports are available. Then there is a serial port for transmission and then the receiving. And these are known as what, the buses, what we have discussed in the beginning of our discussion. There are address bus, there are data bus, and there are control buses, right. As we have discussed, address buses are unidirectional. That means at a time the data movement, at a time the signal can propagate in only one direction. Data buses are bidirectional, right. And then we have a control bus also. Now coming to, right, most of the things we have discussed, right, coming to the interrupt. As name indicates, interrupt is what? Disturbing. Dictionary meaning of interruption is what? Disturbing. The meaning of interrupt in case of microprocessor as well as microcontroller is what? As we have discussed that, to the microprocessor or to the microcontroller, you can interface the external devices. If I take example of a computer, right, To computer, externally we are connecting a keyboard, we are connecting a mouse, we are connecting a printer, we are connecting a scanner, and many things we are connecting. Keep in mind that the externally connected devices doesn't have a internal resources. They depend on the resources of a processor or the controller. If an externally connected device, for example, if a printer wants to utilize the resources available at the CPU, what it does is it will send an interrupt signal to the system. It will send a particular signal to the system indicating that it wants to utilize the resources available. The moment the interrupt comes, what processor will do is, let us assume that process is doing some work, right? So what it does is it will complete its task at hand. It doesn't immediately give the resources to the externally connected devices, because maybe it is halfway through its work. So what it does is it completes its work at hand. It stores all the necessary things, what all the things which are required, and then it will give the service to the externally connected devices. Once that is being done, right, the processor, what it does is it will retrieve all the information which is stored earlier, and then it will continue from where it has left. So in case of 8051, we have discussed that there are six interrupt sources. So again, the number of interrupt sources depends or varies on the different types of microcontrollers what we study or what we have. There is one more detailed architecture of 8051, right? So this is general block diagram of 8051 architecture, wherein we have shown the only blocks, right? ROM, RAM, timers, IO ports, bus control, oscillator. Whereas this is the detailed architecture of 8051, right? You can see that there is an arithmetic and logical unit, ALU. This is there in a CPU, right? Then A and B are known as what, the registers, register A and then the register B. Then we have a one more register known as what, PSW, which stands for program status word. Basically, these program status words have the information about the different flags, right? We'll discuss these things in detail. Then we have a program counter. Then we have a DPTR. This DPTR is known as what, data pointer. This DPTR can be divided into two, known as what, DPH and then DPL. Keep in mind that DPTR is 16 bit, whereas A, B and then PSW are 8 bits. Right, you can see that there is a 16 bit address bus, there is a 8 bit data. Then we have some special function registers which are there in the RAM, right? These special function registers are mentioned here, right? There is a register known as what, IA, IP, PCON, SBUF, SCON, TCON, TMOD, right? TLO, THO, TL1, TH1. What are the meanings of all these registers? What are the functions of these registers? We'll discuss in the subsequent classes. Then we have a ROM here, RAM and then the ROM. Then we have a latch, right? Basically, all these ports are connected to the microcontroller using latch. Right, so there is a port 0, port 1, port 2 and then the port 3, right? You can see that. So all these are, can be used as either input or output, right? All the port 0, port 1, port 2, port 3, right? In case of port 3, you can see that there is an interrupt pin, there is a counter pin, there is a serial data, transmission and reception, there is a read, then there is a write, right? So this is what the internal RAM structure. This part is the internal RAM structure. So there is a byte or bit addresses. There are four register banks which are there in case of 8051. Those banks are known as what, bank 0, bank 1, bank 2 and then the bank 3. Further, this bank 0 consists of 8 registers, register R0, R1, R2 through R7, that is R0 to R7. And similarly, in register bank 1, we have 8 registers, R0 to R7. In bank 2 also, we have R0 to R7. In bank 3 also, we have R0 to R7. That means each bank, that means microcontroller has got 4 register banks, bank 0 to bank 3. Further, each bank has got 8 registers. So 8 into 4, we have 32 8-bit registers, which are known as what, R0 to R7. Maybe having doubt that all the registers in a bank, whether it is bank 0, bank 1, bank 2, have a same name, R0 to R7, then how does microcontroller knows whether this register, for example, whether register R3, which is there from bank 0, bank 1, bank 2, or bank 3, or how to select those particular banks. So we have two bits in a program status word, RS0 and RS1. Those two bits are basically used for selecting a port. We'll discuss those things in detail. Then we have a system timing, system interrupt timers, and then data buffers. Right, you can see that there are a few more controls are there. EA, ALE, PSAN, XTAL1, XTAL2. This XTAL1 and XTAL2 are basically for selecting a frequency. Then there is a reset pin, then there is a power supply, and then there is a ground pin. As in one class we are discussing that, this 8051 is a 40 pin ISA, right? So all these functions will come into those 40 pins, right? One of the pins of 8051 will be doing ALE functions, other pin may be doing PSEN function. We'll be discussing those things in detail. Right? There are many pins are there. Right? More than 40 applications are there, but 8051 has got only 40 pins. So the pins are used in a multiplexed format. Right? That means only one pin can be used for multiple functions. So the previous diagram is the general block diagram or the architecture of 8051, whereas this is the detailed architecture of 8051. So this basically tells you what exactly CPU has got, right? This part is known as what? CPU. Right, coming to the registers, as we have discussed that there are different types of registers are there. A, B, program status word, R0, R7, register banks. So briefly we'll go through these registers, right? So registers, as we have discussed in the case of yesterday's class, right, microprocessor or microcontrollers, they are basically used for storing the data temporarily, right? We are doing some operations, we are getting some result, and we want to store them temporarily. So those results can be stored in the registers. The basic reason for storing these temporary result in registers, because they are very nearer to the ALU, right? If you are looking at the block diagram, so the registers A and B are very near to the ALU. The meaning of nearer is what? The data can be stored or data can be retrieved from them in a shorter amount of time. Whereas if you want to store the result into the memory, which are not nearer, and also for accessing the memory, we need to generate the address, right? So time taken will be more. So it is always suggest that if you have a result, if you have a answers, if you have a information to be stored temporarily, then prefer the registers. That information can be a byte of data to be processed or an address pointing to the data to be fetched, right? So the registers basically consist of both the information, maybe data or maybe an address. The majority of the 8051 registers are 8-bit. There are few registers which are 16-bit. Right, we'll discuss them. But most of the registers what we have in 8051 are 8-bit registers. So the 8-bit of a register are shown from MSB, that is D7 to the LSB D0. MSB stands for most significant bit, whereas LSB stands for least significant bit. With an 8-bit data type, any data larger than 8 bits must be broken into 8 bit chunks before it is processed. Right? As we have discussed that if you have a 16 bit data, then you divide that 16 bit data into two parts, right? Lower 8 bit and then the higher 8 bit, and then you process it separately. Now basically the registers looks like this, right? So there is a D0, this is known as what, least significant bit. Then D1, D2, D3, D4, D5, D6, and then D7. D7 is known as what, most significant bit, MSB, and then the LSB. So the most widely used registers is known as what, accumulator. A stands for accumulator. For most of the arithmetic and logical instructions, always it is advised to use accumulator, right? And in most of the cases, the default register is accumulator. But as in when we discuss the programs, we'll get to know the significance of this register accumulator. Then we have further 8-bit registers known as what register B, and then register 0, R1, R2, R3, R4, R5, R6 and then R7, right? Again, keep in mind this R1, 2, R7 are there in a register bank, and we have discussed that there are 4 register banks are there, bank 0, bank 1, bank 2, bank 3. So these registers R1 to R7 may be of a bank 0 or bank 1 or bank 2 or bank 3, right? There is a difference here, right? As we are discussing that 8051 is a 8-bit microcontroller and most of the registers are 8-bit. But for a change, we have a 16-bit register known as what? Data pointer, right? You can see that a data pointer is a 16-bit. And this 16-bit we have divided into two part, higher part and then the lower part, DPH and then DPL. And then we have a one more register which is 16-bit, is known as what, a program counter. So these are the structures of the registers. A small example is given, right? This may be difficult because we have not discussed the instructions. But still, we'll try to understand the meaning of this instruction. Right? If you are looking at this instruction, right? There is an instruction known as what, move, destination, comma, source. Here, move is an operation. The meaning of move is what, the transfer of a data, right? Transfer of a data. So, where is the data? The data is there in a source. Right, we need to move or we need to transfer this data from source to the destination. So basically, what is the function this instruction is doing? It is copying the content of source into the destination. So if you are looking at the instructions, these are the different instructions which falls under data transfer instructions. Move, A is the register which is 8-bit, comma, hash of 55H, right? Keep in mind that in most of the cases, the H stands for hexadecimal, as we know that. If you don't mention, the default value will be taken as hexadecimal. So after the execution of this particular instruction, A will be copied with a data 55. Right? This is also known as what, immediate addressing mode. Right? We'll be discussing this in the subsequent module. We have a separate topic on addressing mode. Right, then we have a one more instruction, move R0 comma A, right? So the whatever we have in A, that is copied into R0, right? Prior to this instruction, A we have copied with 55. So after execution of this instruction also, R0 becomes 55, R1 also becomes 55, R2 also becomes 55. Right, now here you can see that register R3 we are copying with 95, right? Again, hash stands for immediate addressing mode. So after execution of this instruction, R3 becomes 95, and here R3 to A means again A becomes 95, right? So this is the example of what, the instructions where we are using the different registers, right? A, R0, R1, R2 and then R3, right? To summarize, in today's class we have started our discussion with the difference between microprocessor, microcontroller and then the embedded system. Right, block diagram wise we have discussed that microprocessor and the microcontroller, the major difference between these two is what? In microprocessor, all the necessary things which are required, like RAM, ROM, IO, timers, interrupts, are all there outside the chip. Moment you bring all these things on the chip, it becomes a microcontroller. Embedded system is the extension of microcontroller, right? Don't get confused with term embedded. Embedded may use microprocessor or may use microcontroller. Again, in most of the cases, embedded systems uses the microcontroller. But there are few areas, there are few applications wherein microprocessor can also be used. Then we have discussed about the different criteria which are used or which are required before selecting a microcontroller, which type of microcontroller we need to use, right? Right, the term we have discussed is the speed, we have discussed the package, we have discussed about the power consumptions, the amount of RAM and ROM, number of IO ports required, number of timers you require on chip, easy upgradation, then the cost, then the available software for debugging, then wide availability, the reliable sources, right? All these points are basically required for choosing a microcontroller. And then we have discussed the basic block diagram of microcontroller, architecture of microcontroller, and then the detailed architecture. And briefly, we have started our discussion on the registers. Whereas in tomorrow's class, we'll be discussing about the further registers, what we have in 8051, the special function registers, and the program counter. All these things we'll be discussing in detail. The program status word, we'll be discussing these things in next class. Thank you.